This is Mike Zaretsky at the Colorado Fetal Care Center within Children's Hospital of Colorado, and I'll be talking to you about the evaluation of congenital diaphragmatic hernia. Congenital diaphragmatic hernia occurs in approximately 1 in 3,000 pregnancies and is thought to be due to the failure of the pleural peritoneal canal to close by 9 to 10 weeks of gestation. And this results in abdominal contents herniating into the thorax. And this results in two main lung problems, which are pulmonary hypoplasia and pulmonary hypertension. The evaluation of the fetus with a suspected CDH should include a detailed ultrasound examination to confirm the diagnosis, detect possible associated anomalies, and measure and determine prognostic information, including the observed to expected lung-to-head ratio and whether the liver is within the thorax. Approximately 60% of these cases are isolated, and 40% may have additional anomalies that can be associated with genetic conditions or syndromes. For example, cardiac defects are the most frequently found anomaly with congenital diaphragmatic hernia. For these reasons, we discuss the risks and benefits of amniocentesis and encourage this testing. Most genetic conditions will be found in non-isolated cases with multiple anomalies. However, a growing number of genetic diagnoses are being made in what was otherwise considered an isolated case. To characterize a lesion further, we want to know whether it is left or right-sided, whether the liver is up or not, and to what degree. And then we want to obtain measurements of the lung-to-head ratio, which then gives us the observed to expected lung-head ratio. As you can see in this graphic here, there are multiple ways to measure the lung-to-head ratio. There is the anterior-posterior method, the longest dimension method, and the trace method. Also, you can see in this graphic here that the LHR increases with gestational age, whereas the O to E LHR remains more constant throughout gestation. We prefer to get this measurement after 22 weeks, and we schedule most of our patients around their 24th week. Recent literature suggests that the trace method reduces both inter-observer and intra-observer variability within and between major treatment centers. Other anatomic information that may be helpful include the location of the stomach within the thorax. Fetal MRI may help determine and characterize the extent of liver herniation as well as lung volumes. Additionally, fetal echocardiography can assist in ruling out associated cardiac defects and assess for other prognostic signs, including those associated with pulmonary hypertension. At the Colorado Fetal Care Center, we will consider a diaphragmatic hernia severe when the observed to expected lung head ratio is less than 25% for a left-sided lesion and less than 45% for a right-sided diaphragmatic hernia with the liver herniated within the chest. As you can see in this chart, there are marked differences in survival once a left-sided hernia drops below 25% O to E LHR and below 45% for right-sided lesions. In severe cases, we'll discuss and offer patients an opportunity to enroll in the TOTAL trial, which involves fetoscopic endoluminal tracheal occlusion, or FETO. Also, in select cases, we'll discuss and offer scheduled delivery by cesarean with ECMO immediately available. Because we are a major referral center that sees a high number of congenital diaphragmatic hernias each year, we have one of the highest survival rates in the nation. We also have ECMO capabilities should this be required and have a team that specializes in neonates with pulmonary hypoplasia from all causes. After referral, a patient will undergo a detailed ultrasound, fetal echocardiogram, and fetal MRI. And this is followed by a multidisciplinary team meeting with the family. This will all occur under one roof and on the same day, and they will meet the CDH team, which includes pediatric surgeons and neonatologists who will be directly involved in the care of the baby immediately after delivery. For less severe cases, we plan an induction at term with the goal for a vaginal delivery. Delivery will occur with the multidisciplinary team on immediate standby in the same place where the baby will be treated, avoiding the need for a risky transport of the neonate. And for more severe cases, we may plan a scheduled cesarean delivery with ECMO immediately available should initial ventilation prove inadequate. We have coined the term for this procedure, cesarean with ECMO standby. This has been Mike Zaretsky at the Colorado Fetal Care Center within Children's Hospital of Colorado. If you have more questions, please do not hesitate to contact us for more information. Thank you very much.